In today's episode, we are talking about chapters 3, 4, and 5 of Habits for Holiness, and we are going to dive into creating a Catholic culture, living a life of simplicity, and learning to respond to the cries of the poor. We hope that you enjoy.
Welcome to Life Beyond the Chariot, a faith and family series from the St. Philip Institute. We believe we are called to not only know, but also to live the truth of the gospel within our homes, in our workplaces, and beyond. We believe we are invited to encounter Christ in the messiness of day-to-day life and to live as his disciples. Hey everyone, thank you for joining us once again on Life Beyond the Chariot. This week, we're diving into part two with Habits for Holiness. We're continuing our Advent series. But before we get to that part of the conversation, just a reminder that if this podcast is something that you have enjoyed, we invite you to leave us a rating if you're listening on Apple Podcasts, or really subscribe to the St. Philip Institute YouTube channel so you don't miss out on anything.
Yep.
But yeah, some good stuff coming next year. But how are you doing, Mickey?
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. You know, into the Advent season, and I did much better planning. So it has felt a little bit more peaceful and calm.
Good.
Yeah, and I've just really enjoyed reading this book. It's definitely helped me to refocus on intentionality.
Yeah.
For me. So I'm excited to dive into these next chapters.
Yeah. Me too. This has been a really good book as far as like the practical side of growing in holiness, because sometimes it's really good to just have somebody kind of take you by the hand and say, do these things, focus on these things for the next little bit. Because as the year ends and we're starting a new year, and then before we know it, Lent will be here. So the church just gives us these beautiful liturgical seasons to really think and pray about how we can continue to draw closer to the Lord. So this week we're talking about chapters 3, 4, and 5. And the first one being Catholic culture and liturgical living, more than patches. And one of the things that I really appreciate about this particular chapter with Father Mark Mary is this idea that our faith should affect everything, mm-hmm. because it's so easy to compartmentalize our Catholicism.
Yeah.
Like Catholicism is something that I do on Sunday, or it's just during my prayer time, but really that it should be something that actually transforms the way that we live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he starts off with this quote by Frank Sheed, and he says something along the lines of, like, Catholics today don't have Catholic minds so much as worldly minds with Catholic patches. Mm-hmm. And I love the example that he used, probably because I have a sweet tooth, but he uses the example of chocolate chips.
I like that.
And he says, is our Catholic faith like leaven mixed in and giving life to every aspect of what we do, what we say, and our approach to the world? Or is it more like chocolate chips baked into a cookie? They're there. They're substantial and you can see them, but many parts of the dough have not been touched by them. So in this case, like, we don't want to be chocolate chip cookies. You know, we want to be like leavened bread. And that just really stood out to me because, like you said, like creating this culture, like a family culture, our life as Catholic Christians, it is really should affect everything.
Mm.
And I wrote a little note that's kind of scary, that every single aspect of my life should never go untouched by my faith, by Jesus.
Yeah.
And to always keep that in mind, you know, how we spend our time, how we spend our money, how we engage in relationships, choices that we make, things that we think, you know. I mean, there's so much in here. And so.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. No, I really like that. And I think one of the things that comes to mind is like this idea of evangelization, that it's not even so much like, it's really good that we are catechized and we know our faith and we know all the apologetics and ins and outs of the catechism, all of that. But if our Christian Catholic faith is something that affects every aspect of what we are, if we are if we're not the chocolate chip cookie and we are leavened bread, that people will see that And it will not only affect the relationships that we have with each other, like as a family, but mm-hmm. also in the world in which we live. And the world needs that that witness of joy. So.
Yeah. And I think, too, we need to be living in that witness of joy. Like, I just feel like there's so many things that we're, I don't want to say missing out on, but not really giving an intentional look at, you know, as far as our... there's not much we can do to control the culture that the world sets before us, but there is, especially as parents, there, like, that's our role, is to create the culture of our family. Mm-hmm. And as parents, we have absolute power over that, right? On what we allow into our home, what we choose to focus on. And so just sitting with the question, like, have I allowed my faith to permeate every aspect of my life? Every aspect of my family's life, and how to do that, you know, not with like a rigid, like dictatorship kind of mentality, but as something like, hey, we do this because it brings us joy. Mm-hmm. And does it actually bring us joy? And I think that's something that we as individuals need to look like. Am I joyful in living out, like allowing my faith to transform me and to change me?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And that, I think it's on page 43, talking about culture as a greenhouse. There was one line in particular that really struck me with this, that kind of connected to what you were saying. We're trying to live holiness in the midst of the world, and our experience in the world may harm what God is trying to grow within us. Like, if we are so consumed by the outside, how are we going to make space for what God is trying to do within our homes, within our individual selves? And yeah, just being receptive to that. And also thinking about, like, what type of culture are we building up? Because I think I wonder if it can kind of go to two extremes. We've got the one side where it's very worldly, and we kind of let the worldly things in, and we let society really dictate, like, oh, well, as a parent, these are the things that you should be doing. And that really leaves the faith element out of it. But on the other side, too, sometimes I feel like, maybe this is just me, but sometimes I feel like as Catholics, sometimes we can build up a culture around individual people, like just following a particular person, and that person not being our Lord Jesus Christ, but that we're so drawn to just one person that we forget that it's Jesus. It's not one particular person or one particular ideal or even community, but that it's Christ that's at the center of that culture, and that he's the one that we should be pursuing, I mean, relentlessly, but not looking to people. Because sometimes if we look to a person to determine, like, the Catholic culture that we're going to be living in, ultimately, I think we're going to be disappointed in the end, because that person is human or those people are human. That Christ really has to be the one that's at the center and the foundation of everything that we're doing there.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, too, keeping in mind when we're talking about creating a family culture, like, this should be something that parents discern and pray about, like, Lord, guide me, because all of it, right, should be centered on Jesus and the teachings of the church.
Yeah.
But sort of how the character, kind of like when you think of, like, religious communities, there's all different kinds of charisms, and God calls us to something. I think the same thing for a family. Like, there's certain charisms that are going to just come from your family and that God wants to breathe into your family. And it's our job as parents to be open and to be in constant discernment on what is God calling me to. And so focusing on that, we can look to individuals to maybe help us in that process. But like you said, being fixated on, like, a person other than Jesus Christ and his church, that can just sort of give us, I think, sometimes a narrow view. Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And with this idea of culture, I really liked how he moved into looking at our relationships, the relationships that we have with one another within the family, but also with those around us, and specifically through things like spiritual conversations. Like, how are we having these types of conversations with our children? And knowing that if we do that, that's an effective way of passing on the faith, is like talking about what we believe, praying together. Of course, I think we all know that we're supposed to pray together, but maybe making it more intentional, the beginning and end of our day, and then even setting goals together, setting goals as couples, but also even just as a family, like where do we want to be? Where are we headed?
Yeah. And I think too, and I don't know if I just think this way because I taught high school for so long, but by the time I got them in high school, they were so touched by the culture. Mm. And it permeated so much, mm-hmm. Especially with technology. It definitely helps in being more in tune to what's going on in worldly things. And I think one of the things is understanding for ourselves and for whoever else we have relationships with is that our lives, they should be radically different than the culture. And I mean, not to be radically different just to be radically different, but knowing that Jesus and the teachings, they are different. They love of God first above all else, love of neighbor, detachment from sin, not giving into temptation, selflessness and not selfishness. I mean, the list could go on and on. And so I just think explaining that to the people in our care or even the people in relationships with, like, this is really important to me, and it's going to affect everything, And so one of the things that he had talked about, just really thinking, like, does my life look different because I'm following the teachings of Jesus, from what I watch on TV to what I listen to? Right. And I think the reason I really focus on that is because that was almost always the distraction for my students, mm-hmm. is the latest new Netflix, whatever, and music. And that was the one thing, and this is how I knew they were super attached to it. That was the one thing they're like, nope, I could never go without music for Lent. Do you know what I mean? Or I could never not watch the series. And so the attachment to those things, like, so what are they, and what are we allowing ourselves to spend our time on? Social media, are we understanding the cry of the poor, which is what we'll get into a little bit later. How do we spend our money, our conversations? What do we spend our time talking about? Reading, studying, just everything.
Right.
So,
right.
Anyway, sorry, I kind of backtracked a little bit. But
No, that's really good. That's really good. And I guess just kind of wrapping up with chapter 3, he talks about living liturgically and some very practical suggestions there, and thinking about, I love being Catholic so much and I love the liturgical year that she gives us, and just these opportunities to really reflect on holiness, these opportunities to draw closer to the cross, because we can become complacent. It's very easy to fall into a rut, but that the church constantly calls us back, and that's a beautiful thing. And then, of course, like we have said multiple times, that one of the best parts of this book is just the practicality. So taking the next best step, really thinking, okay, what if this is a spiritual, this is a spiritual life. And so it's a real journey. It's a pilgrimage. So we're not going to figure everything out overnight. Mm-hmm. And it means that at different parts of the journey, God may be calling us to different ways of building up that culture within our homes, our workplaces, etc. But to take it little by little, which is a very refreshing thing. And I think really for Catholic families especially, what is one way that we can really start living our lives more liturgically and really plugged in? I know for our family this Advent, this has been one of the first times where I've really felt like my kids are really tuned into, we got an Advent wreath, and like there are different meanings to the candles and things like that. So we may not be doing all the smells and bells or like all the Catholic Pinterest things, but we're tuned in this way. And so I feel like that's giving us confidence to kind of move into the next liturgical season. So.
Yeah, I agree. I spent a little bit of time just focusing on, okay, what are like the two like feast days? Because that's something that we're not really great at doing at my house is celebrating feast days. And so I picked two during Advent. I was like, we'll do St. Nicholas. And then we'll do Our Lady of Laredo.
Nice.
Because Laredo is where Our Lady grew up. And so instead of making a typical gingerbread house, yeah, we're going to make a gingerbread house for Mary, you know?
That's
and
awesome.
I think that it's great to, I don't want to always be that mom who's always like Catholicizing everything because yeah, I don't want to be like, oh, here she goes on her, you know? Because I do think there's just like some fun and silliness that can happen.
Yeah.
But I was like, you know, they just enjoy making something and then to tie that to something religious. So those are the things that we're doing, but
beautiful,
it can be overwhelming. But taking the time to plan like, okay, if we just celebrate one.
Yeah. Yeah.
One. And this is something that we do at the beginning of every year is we'll pick a saint for the year. There's like a
oh yeah, a the saint name generator.
Yeah, yeah, saint name generator. And so what we try to do is celebrate that saint's feast day. So we get a saint for each person in the family. And then if that's the only thing I do, or if we just do one, it's better than what we've
that's
done
awesome
in the past. But yeah.
Good. Good. No, that's awesome. All right. So, and I know you had mentioned detachment, and I think that flows really well into chapter 4. So simplicity, the Christian call to contentment. And I'm really glad that there was this discussion on detachment and letting go. And then of course, with the following chapter talking about, you know, how are we serving the poor? And that we have an attraction to simplicity, especially in the culture now. He talks about how millennials have been really drawn to like minimalism, mm-hmm, and like the Marie Kondo way. And just this, we know that there is part of us that knows that stuff is not going to make us happy. And yet, I have Amazon Prime on my phone and it feels good to be able to say, oh yeah, I need that thing, I forgot, order, and it's there in 2 days. Oh my goodness. And God forbid it should take 3 days to get there. So, but like this on-demand culture that we can really get fixated on, especially at this time of year,
mm-hmm,
marketing is a lucrative business because
everybody needs it,
right? Right. And they want to create that desire. But yeah, that the on page 54, one of the big things that I underlined was there is a pearl of great price and it is worth all you've got, intimacy with the heart of God. And that really struck me because it's like, do I recognize that intimacy with God is the most important thing in my life,
mm-hmm,
that there's nothing more important than that, even with all of the stuff and things to do and all of that, that is worth sacrifice and letting go of whatever else may be important to have union with the heart of our Lord.
One of the things that that he said was just the idea of contentment. And in the back of the book, they have a contentment check for, mm-hmm, the lady. So just going through those questions. And I think sometimes, especially, I don't necessarily remember being this way before I had kids, but since I had kids and life just gets busy and every day is different because, mm-hmm, well, you know, they have free wills and unpredictable. And but I think in all of that, like in a sense, reacting to just what life brings with little ones is that I have allowed myself to lose focus of just doing this sort of reality check often enough for it to be like, okay, this is something that I need to do or something I need to detach from, or, you know, we may not need all of this stuff for our kids. Mm. And that's just been something that was really helpful to me. And realizing that we can absolutely be happy and at peace with much less. And probably if we had much less, then we would start to see that there's a lot of freedom and peace that comes with that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. And some of the things that he, I loved how he talked about, like with detachment, he said it's not just letting go of lesser things, but like you're talking about intimacy with God. It's also that we can attach ourselves to something better, mm, and a higher good, and ultimately, mm-hmm, the highest good is Christ. Mm-hmm. So I just really appreciated putting that into context.
Yeah. On page 57, I just liked how direct he was, where he says, you know, if I don't choose to be content with what I have, I'm going to trade my contentment, my peace, for very, very little. Mm-hmm. We do have to choose contentment to intentionally allow our reason to speak to our juvenile passions with some tough love. Quiet down. You don't need it. You'll be fine.
Yeah.
It's like, yep, I probably need to put that on a sticky note. Right. Somewhere.
and I'm trying to think, like, and I just want to share this story because it had a huge impact in my life. Well, when I tend to read things like this, my initial response is to go to the extreme. Mm. You know, we need to sell everything that we have, live in a tiny home, you know, and it's okay to have nice things. Mm. But also knowing that, like, am I attached to it or am I detached to it? Like, one summer I was doing this like pro-life mission trip across the United States. And we had been walking through like the desert of like the West until we got to El Paso, and we were hot and my team was tired and we just had tension in the team. Cause when you're with each other all the time and you're hungry and you're tired, you know. And there was this sweet family in El Paso. I remember exactly where we were. I don't remember their last name though, but they had a nice home, but they could sense that there was tension in our group. Mm-hmm. And they said, they gave us all water guns and they're like, have fun. And we're like, but we're in your house. And they're like, okay. They're like, everything that we have is for the Lord. Oh. And so I'm not recommending that you should just allow your children to have water fights in your home. But I think what struck me so much about this family is, even though they had a nice house, like, they were housing 12 college students who were smelly from walking across the country, but they recognized, like, okay, they need some silliness to occur. Mm-hmm. And it's okay if we get water on our couch. Like, they seem to be in tune with, it's water, it will dry. This is kind of what they need. Yeah. And I remember, like, that moment was the time that I really remember having, like, fun with my teammates, you know, that it was, anyways, but their detachment from their stuff, even though they had nice things, was just like, it's all the Lord's. Mm. And if God is calling us to give away our couch, we'll give away our couch, you know? And so it was just, that stuck with me. Like, that's what detachment means, is like, it's okay if God calls me to use what I have for something, I'm gonna do it.
Yeah.
You know?
And do we make space for God to use those things? Like, do I think of my stuff, my home? Do I think of it as this place that should really be at the service of my domestic church and those that I welcome into it? I know we've talked about hospitality in other episodes, but that's a really good way to approach it. No, I love it. I love it. That he's moving towards, you know, this love for the poor. And I like that he kind of lays a foundation for this in chapter 4. But really just saying it very directly, like, we need to hear the cry of the poor. And God loves joyful givers, but he also loves, but also giving gives joy. Mm-hmm. That sometimes I think there can be this fear. I know, just speaking for myself, like, this fear of, well, if I detach too much, or we're not going to have enough to function, or or life is going to be more difficult. But it's like, it's making space, just making space for the Lord to be present. Because if my life is so full of stuff, where I'm so fixated on things being a certain way, or making sure that my material needs are met, and there's never a discernment or a conversation about, like, okay, well, what is God calling me to give back to him? We're missing such a big opportunity there to attach more intimately to Jesus.
Yeah. The Transfiguration is probably one of my favorite stories in scripture. And I've never really thought about it the way that he mentions it in this book, but he says, remember that it was on top of Mount Tabor, away from the common comforts and challenges of everyday life, that Jesus was transfigured, revealing his glory to his apostles. There's something in that for us. If we want to truly see the beauty of God, if we want to fall deeply in love with him in a way that is intimate and profound and fulfilling, it will be in part the fruit of a simpler life, you know, of going up to the mountain away from the comforts of everyday life. And I just never really thought about that way. And it's just good to remember attaching from those things to more attached to eternal realities and to really see the glory of God and like what he's doing in my life. So
yes, absolutely. The practical tips at the end of this chapter are, again, very solid. But I mean, thinking about, you know, be careful what we look at. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're constantly scrolling through Facebook, Facebook is not dumb. And I know our phones like listen to us or
it's crazy, whatever.
It's really, it's kind of creepy sometimes. But to like be having these conversations about like, oh yeah, we should look into getting this thing. And then all of a sudden there's five ads on your Facebook feed for that particular thing. But really to be careful at what we look at, because right now, especially it's like, well, you want your children's Christmas to be super magical. You have to have this toy,
right.
Or you need to do this thing. But really being discerning about that. Also, just really practical things like shopping with a list, making a budget, and doing that contentment check that's in the back of the book. And I think the Friars do it quarterly, so four times a year. And January would be a really great time to start that. So.
Now, I'm not going to lie. There's some questions that'll just, I put lots of bomb questions. Like they just drop bombs. I'm like, oh, I never really thought about that.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's really good.
That's all right. Radically different lives. Right? That's what we're shooting for.
Exactly. So moving to this final chapter for this section. So chapter 5, and I think I found this chapter probably more challenging because, so he's talking about love for the poor. And I really like that he says, this chapter is my attempt to bring the poor to you, right to your door, right into your homes, and to remind us all of how intrinsically a part of our mission and the nature of the church it is to love and serve the poor. Mm-hmm. And I know for me, my initial reaction is like, well, I'm clothing the naked and feeding the hungry on a daily basis in Casa Johnston. Like, how can I even have the mental space to think about folks outside of the four walls of my home? But I love how he unpacks this, that, you know, we have a real responsibility and a real duty to respond to the promptings and workings of the Holy Spirit in our hearts and lives in a way that is proactive and even sacrificial. And if we're not loving the poor, this is on page 69, if we're not loving the poor, it's not surprising that the rest of the world has doubts about the existence of God or the nature of God. Mm. And that, like, it's such an opportunity to love in a very concrete way. But I like how he guides us in this chapter about, like, okay, well, what might that look like in different ways?
Yeah, and he definitely speaks the truth on how important it is, you know, like sort of what echoing what you said, if Christians are not responding, then who will? Mm. Like, if Christians aren't responding to the God who teaches us to give and to help and to serve, and he says everything's not going to be okay because we are called to. And this is what's so great about God, right? He freely of his own will invites us to work with him in his ministry. Yeah. He doesn't need us, but he asks us to do that. Mm. And so we have an obligation, a real responsibility to respond to those promptings of the Holy Spirit and what God is calling us to. And it was just really, like, for me, eye-opening of like, okay, I should really look at, is that something that we've dedicated as a family, like to really just discern, like, what are we supposed to do? Because there's so many things. And I think that's what it is. And he even mentions this in here, is that we can be moved with a desire. Mm-hmm. Like something prompts us. We're like, okay, yeah, we have got to like help out.
Yeah.
But then if there's not a way to immediately fulfill that desire to want to help, that sometimes it can get lost or we just don't know where to go or what to do because there are so many options. That it can be kind of overwhelming, I think. At least for me, overwhelming. Like, there's so many poor. Like, there's so many people who are in need of help. Where to begin?
Yeah. I've noticed that So when we go to Walmart on the loop and 31, when you go to the stoplight, almost always there is someone standing on the side of the road with a sign that says like hungry or looking for work or something like that. And I was driving with my kids maybe it was just Alexandria, my oldest, and she was trying to read the person's sign. And I was so struck by the fact that Alexandria was like looking at the person. She really wanted to figure out like, well, what does that person need? And in my mind, I'm like, how often do I just like, I don't have money. I'm not even like, I'm just going to look to the left because I need to see oncoming traffic so I can make my left turn. But she started asking questions like, well, what does that person need? How do they, why are they doing that? And I explained, you know, they're looking for help. And she's like, well, you know, maybe next time we're here, maybe we can do something. And it struck me in that moment that like our kids are paying attention. Mm-hmm. They're paying attention to how we respond. And I know that not everybody can stop. And I'm really bad about having cash on me, or I know some people will do things like keep snacks in their cars. Mm-hmm. And it just, it made me think for the first time, like, okay, well, how could we respond in a better way to this? And I have memories of my dad before he was ordained a deacon. He would work in downtown Memphis sometimes, or be walking, and he would connect with folks. He'd buy people lunch. And I remember being struck by that. So when he entered into a ministry of service, the diaconate, it made sense, it followed like his witness, like he has a heart for service. And I mean, if our children aren't going to learn that from us, mm-hmm. where are they going to learn it from? But even just the dignity of recognizing the dignity of the person in front of us, if we do encounter the poor, like face to face, like, how do we respond to that? Do we turn the other way because I don't have time to deal with that right now? Or do I take a moment to at least recognize the humanity of the person in front of me?
Yeah, I'm terrible at having cash on me. I never have cash on me. So if I don't have anything, then I'll tell the kids, okay, let's say a prayer for them.
Yeah, that's
a good idea. So that's something that we can do. Yeah. And then one of the things that we used to do is we used to have blessing bags. Mm. And so we just went shopping and just got non-perishables and put them in the bags. And we just kept them in our car. Mm-hmm. Most of them in the back seat, and then, you know, like two or three in the front. So then if we ever saw it, we could just like pass the bag.
Yeah.
And that was a great way because it was always on our mind. We were always prepared if something were to happen. Nice. And then we moved and, you know, life just got crazy. So I think we need to do that.
Yeah.
Reinstate the blessing bag.
There we go.
But, you know, and one of the things that he mentions is I think sometimes he mentioned like, what are some of those things that might keep us from helping? Oh, his section on like sometimes we just pass judgment. Like I'm not gonna give them money because they're just gonna go
use it for
whatever else. What,
yeah.
And oh man, I'm just gonna read this. It was so powerful. He says, "Don't forget, like you and I, we have a Savior, and you and I have been loved with a love of mercy. That love has come down to us and picked us up and pulled us out of the difficulties, the destruction, the chains with which we have chained ourselves by our own sins. You and I are the recipients of a merciful love and not a condemning love." Mm. And then he calls us to do the same. Jesus said, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And for me, I thought that was so powerful because sometimes one of the initial thoughts that come into our mind is like, oh, are they going to use what I'm giving them well? Well, then when you put in this light, like there are many times where I have not used the grace of God well, and he freely pours it into my life. And for me, that was a wake up call. And it's such a great point in something to remember is that I have wasted the goodness that God has poured into me, and yet he does it anyways, you know? Mm. And so for me, like my first thought should not be, I don't know if they're gonna use it properly.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And part of it just giving without reserve is just part of allowing our own heart to grow. You know, they may not use it properly. They may not.
Yeah.
But what it does for us and our soul is it allows us to love more like Christ. So I don't know. That was something that really spoke to me.
No, that's beautiful. And on that same page, and I do want to mention, I know we're kind of wrapping up. There are several stories in this chapter that are very moving, that just examples from Father Mark Mary's life, where he talks about these encounters with the poor and how it was really like this eye-opening moment. But one of the reflection questions in that section on passing judgment, I really felt like I need to sit with this one. How deeply do I live from the truth that I have been loved with a merciful love, a saving love? And I mean, like, really sit with that, because if I am secure in that fact that I am deeply loved by the Father, and that that is the pearl of great price, and that I... that Christ has given everything for me, that should transform how I see everyone else.
Yeah.
If I recognize the great mercy that God has given me in my life, that should totally transform the way that I function in the world. But at the end of the chapter, he says, loving the poor, it is possible, it is necessary, it is beautiful. It reveals the Father to the world, and it reveals the Father to us. So I'm so grateful that this is something that was included in this particular chapter, or just in the whole book, that this call to loving, it's not just about me and Jesus, it's about me, it's about us and Jesus. Mm-hmm. How are we loving others well?
And like, you know, like we've reiterated this numerous times, but like, it's about taking that next step.
Mm-hmm.
And discerning that is going to take our time and our prayer, but just to leave people with, you know, what are ways that our gifts can serve the poor? What are ways our talents mm-hmm. and our resources can be given to the poor? So just spend some time, and I'm going to do this for myself, spend some time brainstorming ideas, mm-hmm. bringing it to God, and just like, okay, Lord, how do you want me to do this?
Yeah, what are you calling me to?
Be a neighbor next door who, you know, who needs help with the water bill. Exactly. I don't know, whatever it is. There's so many ways, but just, you know, carving out time to sit and pray at the feet of Jesus and allowing him to move you into action.
Amen. Amen. No, I love it.
There's so much good stuff in here. I feel like we could go on forever.
No, I love it. If you're part of the Life Beyond the Chariot Facebook group, we invite you to post there. Let us know how or what you're receiving from the book, or what you're, how this is helping your spiritual journey. What are you taking away from it? Are you doing this with a group? We'd love to hear if others are discussing this together. Mm-hmm. And we've got two more sections, very exciting episodes ahead. Yep. And this has been a really good way to head towards Christmas if you're listening to this during the Advent season. But just a really good foundation for heading into the new year.
Yeah,
so
absolutely. Awesome. Oh, this is always so much fun.
Very good. Well, let's end with prayer. Right. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good and gracious God, we thank you for the gift of yourself. Thank you for calling us closer to you. Lord, we ask that you help us to quiet ourselves, especially in this season, that you help us to detach from those things that are not from you, so that we can make room for others, that we can make room for what you are wanting to do in our lives. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.